control the Stockwell Lake Golf Resort Action Group. Unfortunately, the council have published very limited information about this resort, done little public consultation, and are completely ignoring the very real concerns of local residents. They have published this pretty green map with lots of trees and lakes, and it all looks very lovely and innocent, but it lacks any real detail. We're campaigning to stop the resort because we feel they are failing to publicise the real impacts of this resort, negative impacts which far outweigh any perceived benefits. So what have the council told us so far? Well, it's 295 acres of greenbelt land, that's the size of 150 football pitches, a hotel, conference facilities and spa managed by Celtic Manor, two golf courses and clubhouses, a Lynx Academy and maintenance buildings, a large car park, a bypass all Link Road, and an estate of 160 luxury houses, all band H. There was also previous mention of 40 apartments, but maybe David could confirm that. And these are going to be built by Storey Homes. It's clear that this is a massive development that's going to dominate the landscape for miles around and have a devastating effect on the character of the area. We think this is a more representative plan of the scale of the resort. You can see the new Link Road in red, and this will connect from the level crossing to Sogwell Massey Road. And we've superimposed the estate that the same developers built in Llanelli, and it's shown to scale with the same number of houses. So this gives a much better indication of the area of the land that will be concreted over. So why do we think the resort is a bad idea? Well, there's just so many negative impacts, but the main reasons include a developer with a dubious track record, increased flood risk, environmental damage, the resort's not financially viable without the luxury houses, golf is in decline and only 0.2% of tourists come to the Wirral for golf. It's a poor investment for jobs, alternatives haven't been considered, weak public consultation, costs are spiralling. The council has spent so far at least £1 million, and we think it's significantly higher. There doesn't seem to be any financial business plan in place, and it's going to set a very dangerous precedent for building on the Greenbelt. Trying to find a developer since 2002, and no one was interested until the houses were added. All of the other developers dropped out or were deemed not suitable, and the council are very fond of saying that the developer is Jack Nicklaus, but it's actually the Nicklaus Joint Venture Group. The venture group has five directors and they're registered in a house in South Wales. Jack Nicklaus is not a director and personally owns no shares in the company. Nicklaus is merely lending his name to give them kudos with the local planners, and he'll be paid a massive fee to design a golf course. There appears to be a spider web of companies behind the venture group, with companies owning companies owning companies. The same directors' names come up over and over again with each of these companies, and we've even found out that one of these companies is registered in Jersey, presumably for tax avoidance purposes.
Sure.
The main shareholder of the venture group is a guy called James Anderson, and he's an investor and a developer. We think it's all about the houses.
Yes, yes.
If you go to the Nicklaus Design website, it says, Nicklaus Design has been credited with elevating the relationship between golf and luxury home communities. Communities that feature a Nicklaus Design golf course have resulted in the highest real estate value, the highest average home price, the greatest velocity of sales. Anderson's worked with Nicklaus before. His venture group promised to bring a Hilton hotel to the Nicklaus Golf Resort in McInnes in Llanelli. The council were very supportive of the project. They enthused about how the project would be fantastic, bringing jobs and tourism, and put Llanelli on the map. They received over £1 million of grants. Now, the Hoy Lake site is on a floodplain, and the council says, this detailed technical issue is one that the Nicklaus Group have experience in dealing with. However, the Hilton Group pulled out of the McInnes project because of flooding concerns.
Yeah. Yeah. Sounds familiar.
They built a golf club, but the Hilton Hotel has never been built, and all the associated jobs and tourism never materialised. However, the venture group did build 175 houses in McInnes, and this is the estate. Anderson was the director of Carnes Construction, which built the houses at the McInnes site. And after the houses were built, his company went into voluntary liquidation, leaving 81 creditors. Many of them were local suppliers, such as plumbers and electricians, who were initially owed over £1 million. Interestingly, McInnes Homes, of which Anderson is also a director, which sold the houses, wasn't affected by the bankruptcy. Now, Wirral Council say they've undertaken due diligence when looking into the background of the Nicholas joint venture group. Mr. Davis has said there's a Nicholas course down in Wales that we've looked at where they've got a good track record. Given their track record, there's a very high risk that, like in Wales, it just could be the houses that are built and the hotel may never happen. Is this really the right developer for Hoy Lake?
No.
So this is the Environment Agency flood risk map for the River Birket, and you can see that much of the resort lies in the highest risk flood zone 3, including where they propose to build the houses, which means it's likely to flood at a 1 in 100 year storm event. Now, this doesn't mean that flooding can only happen once in a century, but every year there's a 1 in 100 or a 1% chance of flooding. But these flood levels are based on historic data. And with climate change, we're experiencing these extreme events more frequently. Now, planning policy should steer away development away from the flood risk zones. And the Environment Agency will be asked to look at the developer's flood risk assessment. But the council can't ignore their advice. And the Environment Agency can only object if the flood risk is not made worse up to that 1 in 100 year level. Remember, it's not the Environment Agency or the planning officers who will ultimately decide if the flood risk is acceptable. It's the planning committee, made up of councillors, who will give the planning permission. So this is a photo of the golf resort site, and you can see that it's doing what a floodplain is supposed to do. It's flooding. The site acts like a sponge. It stores water in times of heavy rain, so the flood flows or runoff is held back, reducing the peak flood flows in the Birket. And so it reduces the flood risk to Mells and Morton. So what happens when you build on a floodplain? Well, you reduce its capacity to store the water, and you increase the speed of the runoff of the water, because natural areas which soak up water are being concreted over. Large areas of the resort are going to be concreted over. The hotel, the car parks, the clubhouses, the maintenance buildings, and 160 houses, patios, driveways, all the roads. So how could the developer ensure that they get planning permission with regards to flood risk? Well, they'll build what are called sustainable drainage systems or storage lakes, and these will be incorporated into the golf course lakes. And they'll build the floor levels of the hotel and the houses at the road above that 1 in 100 year level, plus a contingency for climate change. They could use fill from another part of the site, but that land is an ex-tip site, and the landfill may be contaminated or not suitable for building on, so they may have to import thousands of tonnes of fill. Now, a golf course half the size of the Hoy Lake Resort was estimated to require 500,000 tonnes of fill. That's about 25,000 truckloads. But if the developer proposes these sorts of measures, they can satisfy planning requirements for flood risk. Now remember, they only have to design flood defences up to that 1 in 100 year level. This is an estate in Ruthin built in 2009, where residents bought their homes safe in the knowledge that their flood levels were actually at the 1 in 1,000 year level. But in 2012, 122 houses flooded. And this is Carl. Double Isle, where their £38 million worth of flood defences were breached, despite being built at a 1 in 200 year level, because Storm Desmond was actually a 1 in 1300 year storm. This is Oaklands Drive near Carlisle just a few weeks ago, where 8 properties flooded because of water running off farmland. Farmland where Storey Homes, the same housing developer for Hoylake, are currently building an estate. Now, despite the local council being aware of flooding problems, they gave planning permission. And Storey Homes says all of our homes adhere to the Environment Agency planning requirements. Now, Storey Homes aren't yet owning up to being the cause of the flooding downstream, but on their website they say, "We continue to support those who've been affected, and we're looking at how we can increase levels of water storage." Storey Homes will be working with the council to ensure that appropriate precautions are in place for the future to prevent flooding on Oaklands Drive. It's absolutely clear that urbanisation increases flood risk. It alters the natural flood processes and it can increase flood risk to properties further downstream. With climate change, it means that the frequency and intensity of storms are increasing, and historical data is no longer accurate when predicting floods. This is some of the recent Wirral storm events. Of particular note is the repeated extreme events of 2012. If you have one event, followed by another, followed by another, the ground is already soaked, the rivers are already full, and quite possibly those Gulf Resort lakes will already be full. So where does the water running off those large concrete areas go to? We're only just beginning to see the effects of climate change, and we simply don't yet know what the effects will be over the coming decades. It's a highly risky, and some would say reckless, strategy to build on a floodplain. Now, while we're on subject of Storey Homes, we've looked at some of their reviews on the websites, and you can see that they've had a lot of criticism for being poor quality, having absolutely no customer service. Is this really who we want to be building the houses on, our quality golf resorts? Site is home to a wide variety of species, some of them legally protected. Waders from the internationally important de estuary use the area as a refuge, and they roost and feed here. Birds include curlew, lapwing, redshank, oyster catchers. Many of the birds are on the Birds of Conservation Concern red list. The small fields, hedgerows and ditches are highly biodiverse compared to intensively farmed land elsewhere. It's an ideal habitat for nesting. Other wildlife includes waterfowl, brown hare, toads, hedgehogs, lizards, bats and barn owls. There are over 100 plant species, some of them uncommon. Farmland managed at low intensity is nearly always good for wildlife, and very little of it exists on the Wirral and Cheshire region. Of particular note is Gilroy Scrape, which adjoins the resort, which until recently was home to 5% of the UK's black-tailed godwit population, until the landowner drained the site. The landowner has submitted plans to develop Gilroy Scrape and the surrounding fields for housing. In 2009, the council received a report which stated that part of the site met the criteria for designation as a site of biological importance, or what is now termed a local wildlife site. However, the council sat on this report and chose to do nothing about it. And if they had, they might have presented the draining of Gilroy Scrape. More recently, the local wildlife site partnership have classed these areas shown in green as an alert site or potential local wildlife site, which is a large proportion of the golf resort area. So can golf resorts be environmentally friendly? We believe that this proposed course would be totally alien for the existing flora and fauna that live on the site. Golf requires the creation of unnatural habitats which are intensely managed with high volumes of water and chemicals. Stormwater runoff from the resort would be highly loaded with nutrients, and there is concern about aquatic life and the Mells Meadow site of special scientific interest downstream, which could be damaged by this nutrient-rich water. The council say the resort will provide opportunities for wildlife enhancement, but the truth is, despite the golf industry trying to portray themselves as environmentally friendly, golf resorts can devastate the habitat which they replace. Now, we're told the course is to have a Lynx Academy, and we think this is likely to be just another name for a driving range. Celtic Manage Resource has a 28-bay, two-tier driving range. There have been complaints about high-intensity lights from the Developers Club in McInnes shining into houses a couple of kilometres away most nights until late at night. There's also the impact of lighting from the hotel, the car park and the bypass and the housing estate. There'll be traffic pollution caused by potentially thousands of HDV wagons at the construction stage and ongoing pollution from the Link Road, including traffic standing at the level crossing every time a train passes. The World Health Organization already say that pollution levels in Birkenhead are too dangerous to breathe. And don't forget the carbon footprint of this resort. The council have done no calculations to assess the massive carbon impacts that this resort will create. The bypass will be a direct link to the motorway via Soggall Massey Road, increasing traffic on a road already used by 100,000 vehicles a week. There'll be traffic chaos at the level crossing every time a train passes. And a study into the effect of new roads by the Campaign for Rural England has shown that these types of roads substantially increase pollution and put massive pressure on the surrounding road networks. And economic benefits were shown to be slower than expected, didn't materialise at all, and most worryingly, were just as likely to suck money out of the area as to bring money in. Passing trade in Mells and Mawson will also be affected. Now, in order to overturn Greenbelt planning policy, the developers will have to prove very special circumstances, and they will use jobs and tourism as a justification. Now, Councillor Davis has said that this resort will be a globally significant tourist attraction. It will bring hundreds of millions of tourism revenue and will create hundreds of jobs and attract thousands of visitors. Now, just think about that statement, a globally significant tourist attraction. When I think of a globally significant tourist attraction, I think of the Taj Mahal or Disneyland.
Yep.
Now, the open at Hoy Lake brought 200,000 visitors, and they say 76 million in economic benefit. But only 19 million of that was direct economic benefit to the whole of the Wirral. Now, the open has happened twice, and it can come again, and its economic benefits don't rely on there being a Hoy Lake golf resort. So where is Mr. Davis getting his figure of this resort bringing in hundreds of millions of tourism revenue? Arguably, he's double counting the open benefits and putting them onto the golf resort. So are the benefits being exaggerated? The golf resort is to provide 175 jobs. This doesn't take into account the existing jobs at the municipal course, the loss of jobs on the farms, the impact on passing trade in Mells and Morton, the loss of jobs at other Wirral hotels and possibly golf courses. And what about the impact on Hoy Lake businesses? A resort such as this is designed to keep people spending in the resort. The council has so far agreed to spend at least £1 million on this project. That equates to at least £5,700 per job. Is this really a good investment in jobs? Over the last few years, the council have made grants to various organisations which have created significantly more jobs at much lower cost, such as the money given to the Wirral Chamber of Commerce, which works out at £69 per job to create nearly 3,000 jobs. So we think you could get significantly better return on jobs by investing in other projects. The Council Centre Resort is projected to bring about 5,500 golf visitors a year. That's just an average of 15 golf visitors a day. Visitors came for the open and they don't need a golf resort in order to come. And the Council's own recent tourism study showed that 91% of visitors come to the Wirral for the coast and countryside. Just 0.2% come for golf. And yet we already have 14 golf courses on the Wirral. Golf is declining. The council have tried and failed to sell off other courses. So why are we investing in a golf resort? Even Celtic Manor's resort only makes 10% of its income from golf. There are plenty of brownfield sites not on the floodplain for building hotels and houses. Yeah. Yeah. Even the council's own consultants have said this resort is not financially viable without the houses. And it's not even a unique proposition. At Halton Park in Bolton, Peel Holdings are trying to develop a golf resort, but they say they need to build 1,000 Greenbelt houses to pay for it. They say it will bring jobs and tourism, it will be a Ryder Cup standard course, it will be the only development of its kind in the Northwest. It will put Bolton on the global stage. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? So are these golf resorts just a smokescreen to get around planning policy to build houses on the building over 16,000 houses on brownfield sites on the Wirral, yet the council are undertaking a review of Greenbelt land. They are currently consulting on the review, but from what we've seen of it, it's going to allow the council to change planning policy to justify building houses on the Greenbelt. The golf resort will set a very dangerous precedent. Already the council have received submissions from landowners and developers for building on the Greenbelt. And this is a map of all the sites where the developers want to build on the Greenbelt. It's obvious to us that the golf resort and the bypass road right across the Greenbelt is going to make it much easier for all these housing developers to happen in the area. So what are the alternatives? Well, if the council really wants to bring jobs and tourism and build houses, what about the Wirral Water Scheme with all of their potential? And there's space for 13,000 new homes. And for Hoy Lake, we've heard all about a wildlife wetlands centre, which we think is a fantastic alternative, with or without a golf resort. Needs is vision, leadership, and innovation to make it happen. Yeah. So in conclusion, we believe this golf resort is the wrong development in the wrong place, and it's a bad idea on so many levels. There are better alternatives with better outcomes, and this project shows a complete lack of vision when they have an opportunity to build a real legacy project. Costs are already spiraling, and they haven't even put a spade in the ground. The council should stop now before wasting any more taxpayers' money. Because once the Greenbelt is gone, it's gone forever.